bring this contest to order.
Yay!
Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's wonderful to see a full and hungry crowd. Who's here for an education? Who's here to see their friends? Or to make new friends?
Yes.
Who's here for inspiring and motivating speeches? And who's here for fun? Fantastic. And who's here only for the bake-off?
Aaron!
I'm glad to see everybody, for whatever reason you came for. I'm going to call a wonderful Toastmaster tonight, Ivan Ewert. Many of you may know him as the Area 46 Director. Do you? Woohoo! Woo-hoo! Some of you may know him as the Meetup Master for the District.
Woohoo!
And if you don't, you should. And by the time we're done tonight, you will all know him as a wonderful Toastmaster.
Yes,
here, here. Ivan Ewert.
Thank you so much, Beth, our North Division Director. Let's have a round of applause for Beth.
Here.
Ladies and gentlemen, Toastmasters, guests, and friends, welcome to the North Division Contest. Now, I'm sure that we're all enjoying a good amount of cheesy pizza, which will help our vocal cords and make sure that we're better understood. But while we're in the middle of that, I have a question. Who in the room has one of these?
Everyone.
Who in the room has two of these? However many devices you have in your pockets, if it chirps, beeps, sings, does a Taylor Swift impression, any kind of noise that it makes, I ask you that you turn it off in deference and respect to our speakers and for the clarity of the contest experience. I have an additional bit of information for everyone in the room. Our contestants have all signed video waivers. Anyone who comes to the front of the room and anyone who is in the crowd may be videotaped by Tim, who is the gentleman recognizable by the camera. If you do not wish to appear on videotape, please speak to Tim directly. All right? With that said, I'd like to move on to recognizing our District 30 dignitaries who are in attendance.
Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo!
Ladies and gentlemen, we're very fortunate to be blessed with the presence of our District Director, Ivory Gwynn. Club Growth Director, Tiffany Howard. Let's welcome Club Growth Director, Bill Morrell. Yeah. District 30's Administration Manager, Eric John.
Hey, Eric.
Our immediate past District Director, Ethel Goatee. Northeast Division Director, Sue Chudasama. Once again, your North Division Director, Beth Weinstein. The A6 Area Director, Mary Matron. N41 Area Director, Jerry Phillips. From beautiful N42, your Area Director, Kathleen Donahue. From the sunny shores of North 43, Area Director, Sherry Miller.
Sherry.
from the charged North 44 area director, Scott Fitzer. From the loveliest place on earth, North 45, Richa Singh. And some guy named Ian. North 46, Ivan Ewart. I believe that concludes the list of dignitaries. Have we missed anyone in the room? Please show yourselves.
Steve Mustaine, Central East, Area 83.
All right, Steve.
Steve Mustaine, Area 83. Has any other dignitary not signed in?
D31, Stella Lawrence.
D31, Stella Lawrence. Does this conclude the list of our contests? All right, thank you all so much. Now, as you all know, today we will have three contests. Because we will begin with the International Speech Contest and the Table Topics Contest. The first contest will be the Table Topics Contest. When that contest has concluded, we will have a 10-minute break. During that 10-minute break, it is your job, should you choose to accept it, to sample each of the baked goods along these tables. You should have received an orange ticket at the desk when you came in. You will fill out that ticket with the number of the baked good that you liked best and drop that ticket into the properly labeled paper bag. This is the only way to ensure full transparency in our elections. After that break, we will conduct the International Speech Contest. And at that point, we will take a second 10-minute intermission, at the end of which we will announce your winners of the Bake Off Contest, Table Topics Contest, and International Speech Contest. Now our contestants, our timers, our ballot counters, and our sergeant-at-arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of this contest. Everyone is aware of the Toastmaster International rules that govern this contest. No one should enter or leave this room during the contestants' presentations. You may do so, if time permits, during the minute of silence that takes place between presentations. So thank you for your attention, and with that said, let the contest begin! I will now give the speaking order for the Table Topics Contest. Contestant number one, Laurel Morris. Contestant number one, Laurel Morris. Contestant number two, Roxanne Wilkening. Contestant two, Roxanne Wilkening. Contestant number three, Brian Shields. Contestant three, Brian Shields. Contestant number four, Sue Rosalewicz. Contestant four, Sue Rosalewicz. Contestant number five, Eric Tetro. Number five, Eric Tetro. And contestant number six, Heather Vaughn. Contestant six, Heather Vaughn. Sergeant at Arms, will you please escort all of the contestants out of the room except for our first contestant?
Thank you.
We are now ready to hear from our Table Topics contestants. There will be 1 minute of silence between each contestant. Timekeepers, when I advise you to do so, please signal me with the green light when 1 minute is up. After all the contestants have spoken, the judges will be given as much time as they need to complete their ballots. We will now begin the Table Topics contest. Table Topics contestant number one, Laurel Morris. What color is your world? What color is your world? Laurel Morris.
What color is my world? My world is fuchsia. And if you don't know what fuchsia is a kind of pink. And it's actually a special kind of pink. In the Ukrainian language, it translates into explosive pink, explosion pink. And that's the color of my world. I think every day is a wonderful gift to us. Just to get up, to breathe, to have a cup of coffee is a miracle, if you think about it, that in this incredible universe that we have, we seem to be, at least in our corner of the world, the only planet with life. So everything, every moment, is like an explosion of fuchsia, of pink. It's a wonderment and delight. And if we look at the average day-to-day things that we do and we take delight and pleasure in them, understand how incredibly unique and wonderful it is to be alive on this planet right here, right now. I think you may agree with me that perhaps in your world too, you will see your world as fuchsia or as explosion pink. Mr. Contest Chair.
May we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Table Topics contestant number two, Roxanne Wilkening. What color is your world? What color is your world? Roxanne Wilkening.
Roxanne Wilkening, and the question that you want to have answered is, what color is my world? Without a doubt, with no hesitation, it is green. Now, you first gonna think it's because of money. That's not it. I have a green, well, I should not say green, because officially it's alien green soul. This car is the most fantastic car I've ever driven. Why? It did not cost me an arm and a leg.
It wasn't 50,000. It wasn't 40,000. It wasn't 20,000. Okay, I don't even want to go on the board because it was low. So green represents an alien. And I am an alien. I represent a human being on Earth as an alien. I came here to represent who? Each of you. I'm representing you in a way that is foreign to some of you. I'm representing you in a way that will show you who I am, what I can do, and what is attainable. Green is alien, it's foreign, it's different, but it's achievable. You one day can be any and everything you want to be by being an alien. You don't have to be the most expensive green car. You don't have to be the cheapest green car. You need to be the best green car. You need to be green, you need to be an alien, and you need to consider yourself in a land that is foreign to you, that you're here to make a difference. You need to show people the way. You need to show them what success looks like, what greatness looks like. You need to make a difference. I'm green, I'm an alien, and I am Roxanne Wilkening, making a difference.
May we have 1 minute of silence? May we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark the ballots? Contestant number three, Brian Shields. What color is your world? What color is your world? Brian Shields.
Answer to that is quite obvious. It would be blue, because two of the things I like most are blue. The first is a bright blue sky.
What can be better than being outside during a nice sunshiny day where you can be outside with your friends doing any activities such as sports, jogging, or even going for a nice canoe ride?
Another thing I like is water, which is also blue. Swimming, going for the canoe rides, as I said, are all things that I enjoy doing in the water, especially when you race each other while swimming.
That's something I used to enjoy doing when I was younger. And when you get to be outside with your friends doing all these activities, it's a great way to meet new people and to have good enjoyment in these activities. I also have blue as my favorite color
because when I was younger, that was always the color I wore on my clothes. So in a way, that helped shape me and helped make blue relating to my world. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
May we have 1 minute of silence while the judges fill their ballots. Contestant number four, Sue Rosalewicz. What color is your world? What color is your world? Sue Rosalewicz.
Mr. Toastmasters, and guests. It's bright sunny yellow, of course. I see everything as bright as the sun at the start of the day. I did recently receive the Miss Sunshine Award at work because people say I always walk around with a smile. I'm always happy. My glass is always, always half full. I'm an eternal optimist. So the only color that I could possibly have is yellow. I love the color because it's the start of spring. You have daffodils that are shooting up. They're one of the first flowers we see. So it reminds us the new growth that we're heading into. You look around you and you see that beautiful sun on days, even when it's only 16 degrees outside, I still like to see that sun. It gives me that extra energy. I could never live in Portland or Seattle, where it's always gloomy, because I need my sun. So my color will always be that bright yellow. Thank you very much.
May we have a minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Contestant number five, Eric Tatro. What color is your world? What color is your world? Eric Tatro.
March of every year, my world is green because I attended Michigan State University, the Spartans. Go green is the rallying cry for the Spartans. And every year is March Madness. And I get so excited because generally, not always, Michigan State tends to do pretty well. Historically, they've won two national championships, one of which while I attended the university in 2000. It's one of the most incredible experiences I've ever had. Because you watch a team that goes from being one of 64, this incredibly crowded field of talented competitors, and you watch them slowly ascend. There's 32, and then there's the Sweet 16. And then the Elite Eight. And then they get to the Final Four and you can almost taste it. It's right there. And then the championship game. The big one. A situation that most people, most fans, never get to experience. Not even the game itself, not even going to a championship. And I remember that game like it was yesterday. Mateen Gleaves, all-star guard, goes out with an ankle injury toward the end of the game. We think, they're doomed, it's over. This is the guy, he's the glue that holds this whole team together. And then, with a few minutes left, he comes back from the locker room, ankle taped up, rallies to win the game, beat Florida, second national championship in school history. My co-students go crazy. They go wild. We flood the streets. The police are there. It's controlled havoc. But so much fun, so much energy in the air. I'm so blessed I got to experience that moment. And every March, when it comes to this time, that feeling comes back. Go Green.
May we have a minute of silence while the judges fill out their ballots. Contestant number 6, Heather Vaughn. What color is your world? What color is your world? Heather Vaughn.
Master, fellow Toastmasters, the color of my world is white. White is a color that is absent of color. That means you can add anything to it that you want. You can take things away from it that you want. You can make the landscape of the color white anything that your heart desires. I think we've all had a time in our life where we felt like we needed to start over. Where we needed a fresh start, where no one knew who we were, and we just a clean slate. And that's what the color white means to me. It means the ability to say, I made a mistake here, I can start over there. The color white tells us that I make my future. I am the author of who I am in this world. No one can take that away from any of us. As we move through our day, from this moment into tomorrow, the color white, whenever we see it, should represent the possibilities of what we can create in our world and in those around us. Mr. Toastmaster.
Everyone, please remain silent while the judges complete their ballots and have them collected by the ballot counters. Thank you.
Mr. Toastmaster, we have all the ballots.
Let's have a big round of applause for all of our Table Topics contestants. Now, while raffle tickets are being distributed through the audience, while we're waiting for that to happen and for the votes to be counted, we will hear from Beth Weinstein, who will give us all the exciting details of the upcoming district. We will hear from Bill Morrell, who will give us all the exciting details. We will hear from Mr. Ivory Gwynn. Mr. Ivory Gwynn, who will give us all the exciting details of the upcoming District 30 conference.
You know, I'm going to hold off a little bit. We got some district business. And I'm going to let Tiffany come up. Tiffany and Bill come up and discuss it.
Jeffrey Ivory.
We'll use the mic even though we're pretty loud. So, what happens in March other than March Madness?
News.
Don't sound so unenthused about your news. So, who here enjoys their Toastmaster membership? Everything you enjoy comes at a price, right? So, Bill, what do they have to do right now?
Well, if you think about it, Tiffany,
$7.50 over 30 days is just pennies a day for a great opportunity to be with friends and be at great events like this. Let's hear it for Beth and her team for this great event! We encourage you, if you have not already paid your dues, or if you know people in your clubs who have not paid your dues, we would love for this to continue. These wonderful division contests, the wonderful officer trainings, and the wonderful events that are coming up, such as our spring conference. And we need you to be able to be excited with that, to not only draw your members in to pay those dues, not only to pay your dues yourself, but also to continue having those new people. Because as we take a look at our numbers right now, we've grown by 40% over the last 7 years. Let's hear it for that. Well done. And this year, halfway through the year, if you look at our numbers, we are again on the rise. Let's hear it for that. Another good year. And that starts with one member at a time. So please, talk to your friends, talk to your neighbors, and continue to have this great organization continue to unfold with the paying of dues.
So the one little tidbit that I'd like to add. So we have a lot of contestants today, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. In order to help them to keep going on to the next level, we have a district conference coming up where they're going to compete at that, the winners of today, with the other eight divisions. Their membership has to be paid in order for them to compete at that next level, and that includes a minimum of eight members paid in your club as well as the competing individual. So don't let them lose sight of their track as part being the district champion for either international or Table Topics, and help them by paying your dues. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tiffany and Bill. I am informed by reliable sources that we will now take our 10-minute break, and we will hear more about the Spring Conference later in this meeting. May I see all of the international speech contestants at the front of the room, please?
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. How are we doing this evening?
With the green light when 1 minute is up. After all of our contestants have spoken, the judges will be given all the time they need in order to complete their ballots. So we will now begin the International Speech Contest. Tom Keefe, The Importance of Turning Gray. The Importance of Turning Gray, Tom Keefe.
Fellow Toastmasters, honored guests, and the soon-to-be-named North Division Baking Champion. Have you recently seen or read something that upset you? Maybe it was a tweet from our president. Maybe it was an angry retort from somebody who didn't like the president's tweet. Maybe it was someone who was upset about the way that we're treating illegal immigrants. Maybe it's someone who's upset about the way we're treating legal immigrants. When you're upset, sometimes you may say to yourself, thinking about those people, they must be crazy. We always seem crazy to other people who disagree with our opinions. And yet the fact of the matter is that all opinions are not always the same. One of the biggest things that people forget is that a black and white opinion is rarely universally agreed upon. Instead, the world sees topics and issues in shades of gray. When we disagree with someone, sometimes we turn into our six-year-old selves. What we do is we stick our fingers in our ears and we say, la 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 la. I'd like you all to try it and join in with me now. Stick your fingers in your ears and let's hear la 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 la. That was fun. It felt good. But the problem was, when we were all la-la-lying, we couldn't hear anyone else talk. And they couldn't hear us. And the other bigger problem is that today, many of us continue to do something like that, just not as blatantly. Take social media. A recent poll showed that 13% of Americans unfriended or unfollowed somebody because they disagreed with their political views. Even more disturbing is that there's a growing trend for people to put up filter bubbles, which means they don't even see any opinion that they disagree with. Well, that reduces their ability to see additional facts or to hear an alternative opinion, or to engage in a discussion with someone. Instead, it's the modern way of saying la, 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 la. And it's diminishing us. It distracts us. It makes us less as individuals and as people. So what do? I, in my experience, have had black and white thinking, which I define as something that's clearly right or wrong. But somebody else might have a different opinion and think theirs is black and white. Well, if you think of black and white in a color spectrum, on one end is black and one is white, and they're as far apart as you can be. And as you move closer through the many variations of color, you eventually come to the middle, where black and white merge into one color, gray. We need more gray in the world. The gray where we're willing to engage with people to see what they think about an issue that maybe we don't see eye to eye on. When I was dealing with my own black and white issues, I benefited from the experience and feedback from other people. And I am not here to tell you some simple solution for how this is going to happen. Because to me, it is going to take time as we build on our experiences and discussions and conversations. The first one that I recall was when I had a conversation with my next door neighbor, Leonard Santo. Now, Leonard was short. In fact, he wouldn't have been seen in the back there if he was standing in front of us right now. But Leonard Santo had a quiet dignity to him. He always dressed impeccably in starched white shirts. And contrasted with his white hair at that time, he really looked mature and distinguished. One day, and I will never forget this, Leonard, on the eve of the Holocaust remembrance, rolled up his nicely starched white shirt and showed me the tattoo that had been put there when he was incarcerated in a Nazi concentration camp. That was a reminder to me of what the Nazis' black and white thinking had done. Millions of people were killed. I've had the experience, conversations with family who are gay and were afraid to come out because of other people's negative opinions. I've had to deal with homeless people who I've every day been diminished and have been ignored just because others don't think that they are equal to them. What can we do? We can engage in those conversations, and if we are willing to look at others and not see the world in our black and white columns, we can have the conversations that go from black and white to gray. To deny it, to defy it, or try to hide it like someone does gray hair covering up would just be crazy.
May we have a minute on the timer, please? Contestant number two, Liz Sacknoth. Leadership is a call to action. Leadership is a call to action. Liz Sacknoth.
John Quincy Adams said, "If your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more, you are a leader." In other words, leadership is a call to action. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and honored guests, how many of you have never faced a challenge or obstacle in your life? In life, we all face obstacles, but it is our actions that define our leadership ability. The great thing is, any one of us can be a leader. It doesn't matter your age, social standing, or beliefs. We all have the capacity to be extraordinary leaders. As leaders, we can inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more. Sometimes leadership comes from the most unlikely situations. It may start with a simple act of kindness. When my son Josh was 6 years old, he became extremely ill. How many of you have ever been around a sick 6-year-old boy? You know something's wrong when they're no longer bouncing off the walls or tormenting his little sister. Instead, my son was wheezing, lethargic, and reserved. It became an asthmatic routine in our house. Get sick, get a nebulizer treatment, get steroids. His dad took him to the doctor while I went to work. I get a call at work expecting it to go a little something like this. Hey honey, can you pick up the prescription on your way home? Instead, my husband nonchalantly says, I'm on the way to the pediatric ER with our son. What? I get the name of the ER, I hang up the phone, and I, as calmly as I could, burst into my boss's office and said, my son's in the ER, gotta go. Luckily back then, there were no red light cameras. As I found my son's curtained off hospital bed, the doctor was there. The next sentence she said, I hope no parent ever has to hear. Your son needs to be medevaced to Children's Memorial Hospital. He was admitted to the pediatric intensive care unit, PICU. You know it's bad when there is one nurse for just your son and one other child. So that night, as I got him ready for bed, I get a call from my husband. Guess what, honey? Elena's not feeling well either. So to make things easier on us, he packed up our 4-year-old daughter, brought her down to the ER at Children's Memorial Hospital. She too was admitted to the hospital, but not the PICU. I spent the next few days with a lot of time in the elevator with my son on the 2nd floor and my daughter on the 9th. The only saving grace was the Ronald McDonald House, just mere blocks from the hospital. In between my marathon elevator visits, I could shower. I'm sure the staff appreciated that I did. Flash forward 7 years later. My third child is now 4 years old, and she grew up hearing stories of her brother and sister being in the hospital. And where do you take a 4-year-old? McDonald's. At this time, she's about counter height, and she notices a box by the cash register. And she says, Mommy, is that where you stayed when Josh and Elena were sick? I told her it was, and how the monies collected help other families be able to stay at Ronald McDonald House. When the cashier handed me back my change, she looked up at me with her big, brown, beautiful eyes and said, Mommy, can I have the change? She took the change and put it in the collection box. Now she could have stopped there, but she was called to action. And she opened up her Little Mermaid purse and took out some of her own money and put it in the collection box. Just 4 years old. That simple act of kindness was my first glimpse at her leadership potential. In the 7 years since, she has led donation drives, organized food bank, and she currently serves on her 5th grade student council. I look forward to the great leader she will continue to evolve into. Her actions inspire me to become more, to dream more, and to do more every day. Simon Sinek, the author of How Great Leaders Inspire Others to Take Action, said, leadership is not a license to do less. Leadership is a responsibility to do more. Many of you in this room are already leaders, whether through Toastmasters at home, at work, or in your community. I ask each of you to answer that call to action. Hone your leadership skills, and with the leader that resides in the core of each of us, answer the call to action. Aspire to be a great leader, a better leader, someone you would be willing to follow. As my daughter has done for me, may your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more. Mr. Toastmaster.
May we have a minute on the timer for the judges to fill out their ballots, please. Laura Blanchard, youthful optimism at any age. Youthful optimism at any age, Laura Blanchard.
Numbers. I love numbers. I love organizing them into spreadsheets, linking them together, creating a chart or a dynamic graph, and if you're lucky, you'll get an infographic. Now that's sexy. Master Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries, and honored guests, I may love numbers, but there are some numbers that are not so easily discussed, like income. Or age. Why is age so sensitive? Now, there are two definitions of age. One is your chronological age. That's the number that increases every year on your birthday. And the other is your identifying age. Now, that's the age that you act, feel, or, well, identify with. I was presented with a discussion on this when I was at the library with my daughter. And another mom and child walk up to us, thinking I'm going to get asked for a play date. Instead, I got, "You are so good with her. How much do you charge?" In reality, it was a few seconds. In my brain, it was an eternity that sounded something like this. Does she really think I'm the nanny? How can she tell I'm not the mom? Do I not act like the mom? Do I need to be nice? Yes, Laura, be nice. Oh, why don't I act like the mom? If you think I'm the nanny, you can't afford this. Is this what a midlife crisis feels like? My chronological age doesn't match the age I identify with? I needed to do some digging on this, so I asked a trusted source. Alexa, define causes of a midlife crisis. A midlife crisis is caused by conditions of aging or a combination of changes in careers, relationships, or problems. Thanks, Alexa. Sounds like I can have a midlife crisis at any age. But that simply didn't solve my answers. I needed some more fulfillment from this. I didn't feel this way. I just wanted to have fun and be happy with my family and my career and in life. I needed someone who had walked these shoes. Mom, do you remember when I was 8 and you dragged me to all of those graduate classes? What was it like? My mom had been a home ec teacher her entire life, but they cut all those programs. And at age 40, she found herself back in graduate school like a 21-year-old with an 8-year-old in tote. But cutting those programs wasn't her problem. She didn't let it get to her. And she took that change like a youthful optimism. This settled me for many years until I gave a speech at my local Toastmasters club talking about personal reinvention. And I got some feedback. That feedback made me realize I wasn't done digging. There was still more to uncover about this. I reflected on another conversation I had had. Grandma, guess what? I just graduated college. I'm getting married, and I'm moving to another state. Well, congratulations, Laura. I gotta tell ya, I got something new today, too. I started a new job. Left speechless. My grandma had gone on to tell me how proud she was, having raised 6 children, run the family farm, and the family bowling business. But there was still one thing left that she wanted to do. And at age 70, my grandma took her first job, working at a flower store. She retired at age 85. You see, my grandma has 18 grandchildren. I was number 5 to call up and share my story of the next chapter of my life. She didn't let maturing children be a problem to her. She took on that youthful optimism and participated in our family journey. I believe that youthful optimism is what keeps her here today at age 94. You are so good with her. How much do you charge? She wasn't asking for a nanny. She was asking for a chance at opportunity. Opportunity is for the young of heart, not just the young of age. And she was looking for that. Youthful optimism at any age brings opportunity. And it's within you, and you, and you. Youthful optimism at any age brings opportunity. What's your next opportunity? And how will you share your story? I look forward to hearing it at a Toastmasters event. Master Toastmaster.
Have a minute of silence for the judges to fill their ballots, please. Contestant number 4, Nikolai Wozniak. Run toward the fire. Run toward the fire, Nikolai Wozniak.
Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests. It was around the time of the September 11th attacks, maybe 2 or 3 days after. I came home, as usual, closed the door, I heard the television. And of course, playing on a loop, with the buildings falling, people running, the bravery of the firefighters and police officers. You saw that constantly. I go in the back room where our television is to greet my father, who's got long, blonde, curly hair, kind of a beard. And I look into his face and he's angry. There's fire in his eyes. But there's also tears streaming down his cheek. And he looks at me and he says, "Nick, look! Look, do you see what's happening?" I said, "Dad, been watching it ever since it happened." He said, "But look, Nick, do you see that? They're running toward the fire. While others are running away. Look, Nick." I said, "Dad, I see." He said, "That's the difference between the people who did this to us and us, and winners. They did what they did, they ran away. But we run toward the fire. We don't back down." I was a sophomore in high school when I took that with me. I kept it right here, I'll never forget that. I go on in my life and work at Underwriters Labs, have a good job. Many of us in here have good office jobs. And you say, how can you apply that sort of bravery to what we do on a daily basis? I know there's times where we allow the mundane, the everyday things we go through weigh us down. Oh, I don't want to answer one more email. I don't want to do that one thing I know I should do. We allow that to drag us down. I was in a situation, I got my first job at Lurie Children's Hospital. I was in the float pool, floating around the hospital. And I had a job where I was asked to work with Microsoft Excel. Scary for me. I had the option to back off of that job and go to another job, something easier for myself. But remembering what my dad said, I said, "No, I'm going to do this job." I went and bought Microsoft Excel for Dummies. Over the weekend, I studied. And by the end of that week, my mentor, a good friend of mine, had his arm around me telling everybody in the office, "Here's the Excel guru. Here he comes." That meant a lot to me. That was my fire. And I ran toward it. I said, "You know what, I'm going to do this." Another instance I think of, I have an Aunt Marilyn, my father's sister. Sweetest lady you'll ever meet. She acts as if she doesn't have a care in the world sometimes. This woman was leaving the hospital in New Orleans, where she was working, and was almost assaulted by 2 men, sexually. And she fought, and she clawed, and she did everything she could to fight. And just when she thought the unspeakable was going to happen, 2 men came and rescued her from that situation. Now, did she let that take her down? She went to work the next day. They didn't want her to. She went to work the next day. And did she allow bitterness to set in? No. She's the sweetest woman I know. She went toward her fire. Then I think of my son. He's 3 years old. His name's Roman. He's about 6 or 7 months. My dad scared him. I told you about my father, a little grizzly.
He had my son in the air when we were playing at our house, and my son was petrified. You could see it on his face. And he's getting closer to my dad, and he looks left, and he looks right, and he looks left, and he looks right, and he doesn't know whether to what to do. He doesn't know whether to cry. And something kicked in. When I play with my son, I play with him, and I gnarl, and I chew on his cheeks when we fight, when we play wrestling. And you know what he did? He got close to my dad, he got angry, and took a bite right out of his cheek. He ran toward his fire. So with that, I ask you to think about the times when you had an opportunity to do a little bit more. I think about those kids in those St. Jude commercials fighting cancer. I think about the first responders that fight and that go toward that fire on a daily basis. Because we're blessed and we have wonderful opportunities every day. And if you don't take advantage of the opportunities given to you, if you don't use your talent and your good health and your good fortune to take on that fire, to take on that thing you know that would put you over the top, if I don't do that, shame on me and shame on us. Mr. Toastmaster.
May we have the customary minute for the judges to fill out their ballots. Jerry Lowers, True Grit. True Grit, Jerry Lowers.
Fellow Toastmasters, and guests, years ago, there was an old TV show called Kung Fu about a Zen Buddhist monk who roamed America's Wild West. Because of his metaphysical training, the guy could find a deep meaning about life in anything, even a stone. One morning, while standing in front of my bathroom mirror, I resolved to do the same thing as that TV monk, with one of the objects scattered around my sink. The first thing that caught my eye was a tube of toothpaste. I grabbed it and held it up, waiting for enlightenment. Hello? 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 Anybody there? Suddenly, the words of a wise old woman came to mind. There's always some toothpaste left in the tube. All you have to do is squeeze harder. Okay, wise old woman, I mean mom, what does that have to do with the meaning of life? Then it hit me. Life is like a tube of toothpaste. Easy when it's full and flowing, not so easy when it's flat and empty. When it's the latter, you just gotta squeeze harder. I felt like I had a key meaning of life at my fingertips, and all in a tube of toothpaste, no less. But for a Buddhist monk, almost isn't good enough. I was missing something important. Wait a minute. Why did that wise old woman, I mean mom, tell me that I had to squeeze harder in the first place? It was because as a kid, I was always running out of toothpaste. So she taught me how to get every last dollop of paste out of every tube. But I also think she was trying to teach me a higher lesson. Suddenly, the word grit popped into my mind. Toothpaste has grit in it, that collection of tiny loose particles forming the abrasive that helps clean teeth. Although that's the first definition of grit in the dictionary, the second definition is courage or resolve. Bingo, I thought. There I had it, a key meaning of life, and all in a tube of toothpaste, no less. In our lives, we all deal with the fear of failure. Yet highly gritty people aren't afraid to tank and view it as just a part of life. They understand that there are valuable lessons in defeat, and those lessons, as hard as they might be, are requisite for high achievement. Eleanor Roosevelt once said, "Do something that scares you every day." She understood that courage, like any muscle, has to be exercised regularly. And courage is what helps fuel grit. And grit is what drives us to go for the gold rather than just show up for practice. Or put less delicately, grit is what makes us resolute in our belief that it's better to be a racehorse than an ass. Also, highly gritty people are supremely confident that things will work out okay, and if not okay, it's not the end, but just a new chapter in the book of life. And so, that wise old woman, my mother, was in her own way trying to teach me that when the going got tough and life was flat and empty, I had to squeeze harder to get my life flowing again in the right direction. And God knows my mother had true grit. Last April, she passed away at age 91 and a half, still active, courageous, and resolute to the end. She was still driving her Buick and talking about her next new one. She was also still living independently in the house that she and my father bought in 1982 when he retired at age 62 and where he died a year later. Her fear of failure could have gotten the best of her so many times, but her grittiness kept her moving forward despite staring at an empty tube. She just always squeezed harder. And so, I know that that wise old woman, my mother, would have agreed with me when I say to you, sometimes, life will look like this, full and able to flow easily. But many times, life will look like this, flat and empty. But don't give up. All you need to do is squeeze harder.
Judges, please.
Kathleen Nannenhorn. Just like that. Just like that, Kathleen Nannenhorn.
One Wednesday, in the middle of a scorching hot bluegrass Iowa summer, my co-counselor Petals and I decided to take our cabin filled with newly teenage girls on a mile-long hike out to the lake. We took down every canoe off the rack, which proved to be a waste of time because after 10 minutes, all of the girls were swimming in the lake next to the snakes, the snapping turtles, and all the little water bugs. But what can I say? We had an adventurous cabin. So after about an hour, I blew my whistle for everyone to come back to shore so we could start our walk back. Whining ensued. None louder than my co-counselor, Petals.
I don't want to go back.
So in an effort to appeal to my adventurous cabin, I suggested we take the back roads instead of the main path back to camp. After all, we had over an hour to walk a mile. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and most honored guests, Ralph Waldo Emerson once wrote, "Do not go where the path may lead. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail." Clearly, Ralph Waldo Emerson was never a camp counselor. Since I had never taken the back paths before, I didn't know what to expect. Not to mention, we were incredibly unprepared. We had no map, no phone, not even a compass. And we let the girls take turns choosing which direction to go. And after about a half an hour of walking, 7 disastrous falls, and countless bug bites later, we had finally reached a dead end. We had 3 options. 1, we could walk through a swamp of thorns. 2, we could start that half hour walk back to the lake and then do the mile walk back to main camp. Or 3, we could hop what was clearly a fence into somebody else's property. Before Petals and I had a chance to sit down, collaborate, decide what to do, the girls were already hoisting each other up over the fence. And within minutes, we were all trespassing in someone else's yard. We decided to head towards the main door when we heard barking. The girls sprinted towards the door, and the girls who were already at the door were using each other as human shields. Luckily, it was just a golden retriever. Our luck ended there because nobody but the golden retriever was home. We started heading towards the very busy road. We played rock, paper, scissors to decide which direction to go. And in a belated effort to put safety first, I went to the front of the line and Petals went to the back of the line. And all of the girls were behind us. I could hear Petals yelling at the girls, "Put your thumbs down, we're not hitchhiking." Which, after another couple miles, turned into, "Put your thumbs down. That car's not big enough for all of us." I'm sorry. But your reactions? That was my reaction too. I turn around to see Ashley, a 12-year-old girl, making her one of the youngest girls in the cabin, sitting down next to a particularly maggot-ridden piece of roadkill. She's crying hysterically. Cammy, who was 15 years old, making her one of the oldest girls in the cabin, knelt down next to her and said, "Ashley, what's wrong?" Ashley composed herself just long enough to point at the roadkill and say, "We're gonna end up just like that!" After that melodramatic statement, we were off on our journey once again, thanks to Cammy, who put her on her back and got us moving forward. And thankfully, just moments later, I could see in the distance the front drive to camp, notable by this old, rickety, run-down wooden sign.
seconds after I saw it, the girls must have seen it too, because they took off after that sign, with Petals yelling after them, "Single file! Single file!" Ashley was the fastest, and she got to that sign, and she hugged it as tight as she could, and she said, "This is the most beautiful sign that I have ever seen." My advice to all of you is, if you must take the advice of Ralph Waldo Emerson and go where there is no path and leave a trail, please bring a compass. Mr. Toastmaster.
We will now give our judges as much time as needed to fill out their ballots.
Mr. Toastmaster, we have all the ballots.
Keep your applause going for all our contestants. Ladies and gentlemen, in a few short moments, we'll be taking our second 10-minute break, where you'll have your final chance to sample the baked goods. But before then, I would like to turn over the floor to District Director, Mr. Ivory Gwynn.
He's doing a great job. This has been a fabulous contest. I would like to tell you a little bit about the upcoming spring conference. We're here to win these trophies today. And I was just, I'm so amazed at all these trophies here and that somebody's gonna be taking it. But before we do that, I'm gonna tell you, thanks, Tiffany. Friday night. What are we gonna do on Friday night?
Table topics,
that's right. But before we do that, we're going to do
dinner.
Recognition dinner.
Food.
And we're not going to do it on Saturday morning anymore. That's done. It took you so long to get up by 4 o'clock. Some of you people get up at 4 o'clock, and by the time you get there, you're not hungry. All you want is a cup of coffee. So we decided to do this on Friday night and just celebrate the district and do table topics and do a little small briefing about how well the district is doing. It's going to be 30 minutes, maybe longer, depends on how I feel. And then Saturday morning, we got business to take care of. We have two districts. We have to elect some officers. So we're going to do District 30, small business, District 30, elections, and the new forming district, District 103. And then we're going to have lunch, and then we're going to hear from our international director, Magnus. And then we're going to decide to come together, and then you can ask me any questions you want to, along with all the district leaders. And then what else are we going to do? Am I leaving something out?
Get educated.
Ah, that's right. All day Saturday, you're going to get educated with, how many education sessions do we have? About 15?
17.
Has there been a change in the... 17, that's a lot. But the main thing we're going to be doing is we're going to have the contest, the international contest. And that person is going to where?
Vancouver!
That's right. Go to Vancouver. So whoever wins tonight comes to the district and have an opportunity to go to Vancouver. And then we're going to do a celebration, and that'll be the last time we'll be known as District 30, Chicagoland. And we're going to have a 10-minute break, and... Thanks, Tiffany. I need these people. I need my people's help. It's going to be at Skokie, where it's been every year for the last 3 or 4 years. Skokie on the 28th and the 29th. Skokie Holiday Inn. You should be receiving an email with all the information, everything you need to know. You can register online. Everything. Go to the district website, look up. How many of you guys received an email in the last few days? You're going to be receiving more. I'm going to also have for the officers a conference call to go over the alignment. So we got to do that also to make sure that everybody understands where they fall. Is it District 30 or District 103? So a 10-minute break. If I forget it, did I forget anything? Okay. Thanks.
We're full of sugar, we're full of cheese. Life is good. Our heads are full of the very best brains and the words that have been delivered to us today. Once again, can we get a big round of applause for all of our contestants? I have some information for our contestants as well. Links to the video recording will be available to contestants tomorrow morning via email. The video will be made public after the spring conference to avoid anybody else seeing your speeches and moving forward with that. If you have any questions regarding the videos, please email Beth at your opportunity. Thank you. And now, who wants to get to know some of our contestants? You do, and you do, and you do. All right, we're first going to interview our Table Topics contestants in the order that they appeared. Can we please get a round of applause as they join me on stage? This is always a fun portion of the evening. We're going to see how long it takes our contestants to remember the first three questions that I'm going to ask every one of them. If you don't need me to ask it, feel free to begin volunteering the information. Our first contestant is Laurel Morris. Laurel, could you please give us how long have you been in Toastmasters? What club are you representing? And what is your Toastmasters educational level, please?
Okay, I have been in Toastmasters since 2009. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Perfect. I've been in Toastmasters since 2009. I'm a founding member of Club Toast at UL, the club at Underwriters Laboratories. And my educational level is I have my competent communicator and my advanced communicator bronze.
And Laurel, we see that you have your favorite quote is, "There is nothing ordinary about decency, courage under fire, compassion, tenacity, and lion-heartedness."
Yes.
Could you tell us a little more about that lion-heartedness?
Lion-heartedness. I think in today's world, people sometimes lose the inner pressure. They lose their zest and their spice for life. And these things like being decent and compassionate feed all of that, so that when you do have to do something brave and lion-hearted, if you've had a life filled with compassion and decency, it really gives you a foundation and a strength for when you need to do something brave.
Couldn't agree more. Laurel, thank you so much. Thank you so much. You go to the end. Absolutely. Contestant number two, Roxanne Wilkening. Roxanne, how long have you been in Toastmasters? What club are you representing? And what is your Toastmasters educational level, please?
I've been in Toastmasters, I'm going on my second year. The club I represent is Daniel Wright.
Yeah!
Okay. Well,
and your Toastmasters educational level,
I
please.
I received my CC in December. Woo-hoo!
And Roxanne, I see here that what inspires you most is helping people achieve their dreams. That is a very human goal for someone who is so alien green. Could you tell us a little more if perhaps your blog helps you to help people achieve their dreams, or how do you go about that goal?
One of the things that I do have a blog, drsolution.com, and what I might aspire to do is to share life transformational stories, because I think we all have a story, and I think stories of our lives is what help other people. They're not necessarily for you, but they're for the uplifting of mankind. And so one of the things that we do is begin to share stories of people's life journey. I do have a weight loss group that we speak every Thursday, which I missed the call today, every Thursday from 7 to 8. I work with young women, men who are challenged with needing inspiration to help lose weight, to help find their voice, because as we know, the weight sometimes is a byproduct of the big picture. And my last thing is I am working on a certificate as a wellness coach, because a wellness coach looks at all dimensions of your life. And as I look at the different dimensions of my life to bring balance, I hope to bring balance to other people or help them.
All right, and in your spare time. Just kidding. Roxanne, thank you so much for a wonderful speech. All right, we have contestant number three, Brian Shields. Brian, can you tell us how long you've been a Toastmaster? What club you are representing? and your current educational level in Toastmasters, please?
So I've been Toastmasters since around the end of 2013. I represent Peak Speak. And my achievement level is a CCNCL.
And it says here that your interests and hobbies are bowling and chess. What do you see? What is it that attracts you about those two rather different activities?
Well, for bowling, I like it just because it's something I've always done for a number of years now. When I was a little kid, I would always go watch my grandfather go bowling. So that's really what started getting me into that. And as for chess, I just play that pretty casually, but it's just a fun way just to stimulate your mind and to just relax for a little bit when you're playing.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Brian. All right then, Sue Rosalewicz. Sue Rosalewicz. I have it phonetically on every other piece of sheet paper here except this one. Sue, could you give us, please, how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you're representing tonight, and your Toastmasters educational level, please?
Okay, I've been a Toastmaster for about 3 years this time around. I was in it previously, prior to children, so in other words, many years ago. I am with Quill.com. Yay! And I'm a slacker, but I'm inspired by all of you now. I've only given about 4 or 5 speeches this time around, so gotta get going.
Work in progress.
Yes.
Well, I don't know that a slacker would show up and get to the division contest. To be fully honest with you, Sue. And it says here that what inspires you most is something we don't get much of around these parts, which are the mountains. So tell us, Sue, what brings somebody who's inspired by the Purple Mountains majesty to these fruited plains of Illinois?
Well, Mama was a city Chicago girl. Daddy was from northern Minnesota. So I've got a little bit of the land in me, but Mama planted roots here. So she made Papa Sulla's farm. So I have to keep driving out of the area. We said, Mama goes sees the mountains every other year at minimum, because that's my solace, that's where I find peace, and there's nothing greater on this planet than finding that inner solitude.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Sue. Congratulations. Eric Tatro. Eric, could you please give us how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you're representing, and your Toastmasters educational level, please?
I've been in my current club, Master Speakers at Baxter, since 2015, and I am currently working toward my CCNCL.
Excellent. And we see here under your hobbies, you've included emerging technologies. Would you like to speak a little bit about the most fascinating new bit of tech that's entered your life or your home?
Emerging technologies, I have a real interest in things that are going to radically transform the way we live and work and communicate in the future. And the most pressing one that we have on our horizon is artificial intelligence. It's going to change everything. From right now, we have your Alexa, your Siri on your phone, but pretty soon it's going to cause massive disruption. We're going to have artificially intelligent cars. It's going to change the workplace. It's going to be very different. It'll be like the internet changed our lives. Artificial intelligence will change our lives as well.
And what could possibly go wrong? Eric, thank you so much for wonderful speech. And last, but certainly not least, Ms. Heather Vaughn. Heather, could you please tell us how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you represent, and your current educational level?
I have been in Toastmasters for 4 years, I think next month. And I have an ACB, and I'm representing Midwest Speaking Professionals.
Excellent. And what inspires you most is people who never give up. Could you give us an example of somebody in your life currently who's inspiring you that way and a little bit of their story?
Well, it's not someone I know personally, but one of my heroes is Elon Musk. The way that he approaches technology and how he's come to the point where he's at today, the whole idea of launching rockets for him was going to be a joke. He had no intention of ever doing it really, like forever, ever again. And now it's turned into a mission to Mars. So when you realize that you can do something out of any kind of circumstance, that shows that you could never have to give up on anything.
Wonderful. How inspiring. Thank you so much, Heather. Let's have a round of applause for all of our Table Topics contestants. And are there any guesses as to what comes after those interviews?
The baking contestant?
More interviews, ladies and gentlemen. Could we have the international speech contestants up to the front of the room, please? Just as with the Table Topics competitors, we'll be asking you three basic questions. Tom, could you tell us how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you represent, and your educational level within Toastmasters so far?
Oh, I could say it without the mic.
I had to say something in reverse.
I've been in Toastmasters for 9 years. Tonight I'm representing VW Credit Toastmasters. Club 111-19. And I'm a distinguished Toastmaster.
All right.
And given the content of your speech, I'm not surprised to see that one of your interests and hobbies is talking to strangers. Would you like to share a short story of somebody recently, the most strange stranger you've most recently spoken to?
There was this guy in this contest, and he stood at the front of the room. He was so clever. He would say things that would just make me laugh about how he was able to tie in something about something that someone had said to what he wanted us to laugh about. It takes a special skill. And that someone, Ivan, in case you don't know it, is you.
Well done, Tom. Thank you so much for that sort of speech. Contestant number two is Liz Sacknoff. Liz, could you please tell us how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you're representing, and your Toastmasters educational level so far?
So I've been in Toastmasters for 9 months. I'm representing Ebbett Toastmasters. And this month I got my CC.
Congratulations. All right, and we have down here your favorite quote. To err is human, to forgive, divine. Now, how often have you found yourself being touched by the divine in needing to forgive somebody recently?
Well, I do work here, so probably quite often. I think that we all make mistakes, but forgiving each other for our mistakes is very difficult.
Difficult but rewarding, right?
Yes.
All right, Liz, thank you so much for an excellent speech. Laura Blanchard, number of years you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you are representing, and your educational level so far.
I've been in Toastmasters for 1 year. I'm representing Figures of Speech 1856 tonight. And I completed my CC. I am one Toastmasters away from my CL, and I hope to complete my ACB with just 4 more speeches left for my Triple Crown this year.
Yeah. Now, under your notable accomplishments, I see that you've supported the directors of music education in Lake County, and you've also listed music as one of your interests and hobbies. So what is the music that moves you, Laura?
The music that moves me is typically whatever is playing at that time. I am very much, I don't have a specified genre. I keep my mind and my options open. I have a master's in music, so music appreciation and what drives other people is also what drives me, because that is how I believe we all find where our intellect is and share ideas. So if I have a choice, I do probably have Lady Gaga on in my car.
That works
just
out.
Saying.
That works out just fine. Laura, thank you so much for an excellent speech. Nikolai Wozniak.
Hello.
Hello. Could you please tell us how long you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club you're representing, and your educational level thus far?
I've been in Toastmasters since 2011. I'm representing Club Toast at UL. And I'm working toward a CL, achieved my CC in December of 2015.
Excellent. Now, Nikolai, your favorite quote, I think, ties in very well to the inspiring speech that we heard today. It is by a wonderful, wonderful man out of history. "We will find a way, or we will make one," by Hannibal of Carthage. What is it about Hannibal of Carthage and that particular quote that moves you?
I'm not going to lie, I'm so happy you spoke to that, because I've had that on in different things I've done and no one ever talks about it. I'm like, I like this quote.
Eerie.
So talk to my quote. But no, I appreciate that. What I like about that quote is pretty straightforward. If you have obstacles, or you know, there are issues, or people tell you you can't do something, don't take it for an answer. Make a way. Find a way. I believe that. I live by that. I also like the figure in history. I'm a history buff, and on studying Roman history, I learned about this guy Hannibal, and I appreciate the underdog sometimes. And I know he didn't win, but he went out guns a-blazing.
Cartago delenda est. He certainly did, Nikolai. He certainly did. Congratulations on a wonderful speech. Jerry Lowers, thank you for joining us again.
Welcome.
Jerry, could you tell us the number of years you've been in Toastmasters, the club you're representing, and your Toastmasters educational level thus far?
I've been in Toastmasters 27 years. My regret is I didn't start sooner. I belong to Deerbrook Park Toastmasters 4868, and I have my ACG.
Marvelous. And I see here, what I'm very interested in hearing about in terms of your interests and hobbies is you are a tweeter.
I am a tweeter. I went to a tweeting seminar at Northwestern University about 5 years ago. I didn't see Trump in the audience at that time. But I decided to get into it, and as one of the first speaker mentioned, it's a great place to learn about the variety of opinions on topics. And not only politics, I mean, I've tweeted on Iranian sanctions and gotten replies from Iranians, and you know, and they have a different view of things, and it is a rich experience in terms of understanding that yes, the world is not straight down the middle and we all believe in the same thing. I mean, there are some variety, to put it mildly, in opinions.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for sharing your handle with those who ask. Jerry, congratulations on next week's speech. And Kathleen Nannenhorn. Kathleen, could we please have the number of years you've been in Toastmasters, the name of the club that you're representing, and your educational level so far?
I have been in Toastmasters for 2 years.
I represent Alto. And I just completed my CC and my CL.
Excellent. Very good. And we have here as well a favorite quote that I'd like to know more about from Dr. Seuss. I'm afraid that sometimes you'll play lonely games too. Games you can't win because you play against you. What is it that quote means to you?
To me, I'm not a very competitive person. It makes me somewhat uncomfortable to compete against other people, and I was never really in team sports. I was in tennis and I was in gymnastics and those kind of things. And I tend to be very competitive against myself. And so sometimes I have to take a step back and not be my own harshest critic. And that's what that reminds me of.
Well, you really are the only person you ever have to excel in life, right? Thank you so much, Kathleen. Another round of applause for our international speech contestants. Have all of the ballots collected?
We do.
Marvelous. In that case, at this time, I would like to call our division director to the lectern. Please help me welcome Beth Weinstein.
Thank you. So was Ivan a fantastic Toastmaster?
Yeah.
And I would like to thank the fantastic contestants. You all did a superb job.
Here, 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 here.
North Stars will be very ably represented in the spring conference.
Yes, we will.
Yes. Yay. I'd like to thank the many, many volunteers who were involved in making this contest run efficiently. That's the ballot counters and the sergeant at arms and the timers and the judges and the, yes, Jim, and the tech guru and all the volunteers behind the scenes. I'd like to thank Patty Anderson for making this room available to us. I think it worked out beautifully. The North Star Division is led by a wonderful team of area directors. They will all be called up when it is time to announce the awards. But everybody, every single one of the area directors whose names are listed in the program has done a wonderful job this year. Don't have an audience. And finally, but definitely not last, what did you think about the bake-off contest? Thank you to everybody who baked. It really made it a lot of fun. I'd like all the bakers to come up here, please.
Cherry chip cookies.
The second one is for Tom.
I'm sorry, it's Mike.
Oh, Tom's over here.
Sorry.
We're not in order.
Okay, this, I know this is Elena.
Yes.
What did you make, Elena?
I made the snowball cookies.
All right.
Steve?
Yes.
What did you make?
High protein brownies.
Nice. Kathleen? What three things did you make?
Lemon bars, Mississippi mud cake, and those North Star cookies.
Yeah.
And the next one I have is, yeah, but I have balloons. Okay, here's Tom. Okay, next is Tom. What did you make?
His wife.
Did your wife make?
The first and best boss I ever had taught me never take credit for something somebody else did. My wife baked lemon bars.
And Valinda, what did you bake?
I baked the pumpkin cake.
I've been smoking.
What did you make, Dennis?
I'm going to follow the lead from my buddy over here. I'm going to give credit to my wife. A traditional favorite in Ohio, the Buckeyes.
Yeah. And Lindsay, what did you make?
Chocolate chip
and
butterscotch cookies.
They all did a phenomenal job. Thank you to all of you wonderful people.
Right there?
Well, you can sit down, but I'm going to call three of you back up.
Just
while
they're still here.
Okay. Excuse me while I get the awards out. I'd like to give all of you gold medals for your wonderful bacon. But what we have instead is... gold medal flower! And the third place winner, Elena for the gumball. Is a little bigger. Gold medal for Tom. Oh, sorry.
Diana.
Mrs. Booth.
Diana.
Lemon bars. And the first place winner. Do we want a drum roll on this one? One more thing. This is the third place award, the second place award, and the first place award.
So, gotta get back to Elena.
Yes, you got third.
The pain.
And the first place award for Bake Off goes to Kathleen Donovan. You've got too many things.
Thank you.
Yay!
Smile. Smile.
Okay, now what we're waiting for. We need to have the dignitaries come up here. I'd like to call the area directors as well as all the district directors. I'd like all the district officers.
I know, so let's sit down. Should we get normal? Whatever you want.
Somebody landed on the table.
Oh dear. Well,
but he's
no.
Well, in the fall. I'll give you a
The winners are going to have a lot of hands to shake.
Good.
We're having trouble getting any lines. Are we ready?
Yes.
Okay, the third place winner in table topics is... Susan Rosa North at the Spring Conference is Eric Tatro. Gather the trophies. And all the international speech contestants, as well as the table topic contestants, were wonderful.
Yes,
yes they were.
But we're required to choose a first, second, and third. So the third place winner in the international speech contest is Tom Keith. Don't wait. It's wonderful.
Now it gets interesting.
And the first place winner and the person who is going to the spring conference representing North Star Division is Laura Blanchard. Congratulations to everybody, and thank you all very much, and contest is adjourned.